It's the culmination and the logical extension of a vicious and stupid system. The difference is clear, crystal clear. In Guinea, the young man and the young woman going to medical school understands properly the value system of the country. He and she knows that they are going to school to serve mankind. Thus, whatever knowledge they possess, whatever knowledge they get, will be put to the benefit of men. In America, the student going to school for medicine is going to school to make money. Thus, as soon as he becomes a doctor, he tries to make as much as he can. This backward system must be fought. You must fight against it, and you must struggle for scientific socialism. I thank you.
All right, all right, all right. Welcome back to another episode of Seriously Joking. We got a great serious topic on our hands today. We're talking about with the reopening of schools and the miseducation, you know what I mean, of the children and the information that's going out. We have been so inundated by so much information on this whole COVID thing. Whereas one time it was just wash your hands and wear a mask. Now it's you're highly susceptible to it if you have respiratory problems, diabetes, hypertension. And I was reading this week that men that are considered obese are at a high risk now. And it just seems that you have so much information that it keeps people confused. So then when you start talking about social distancing for 4 or 5 months or whatever, however long it's been, wash your hands, you know, try not to come in contact, don't touch doorknobs, don't do this. Now we're in a situation where we're about to put children in classrooms and in school buildings where it's 200, 300, 400, 500 people in one building for 6 to 8 hours. But yet they're still saying, oh, well, there's just certain protocols, certain guidelines that you have to follow. You know, most places that you go to shop in can't have over 20 people in the store at a time, but you can have 600 people in one building for 8 hours for learning instruction when it's been proven that you can do it over the internet. I got my man Nube One with me. Nube, how you feel about this whole situation so far?
I mean, I feel pretty much the same way. It's but I think, you know, part of it is, you know, people are still kind of learning about the disease or, you know, the virus, whatever. What is the, yeah, the coronavirus. And so information is going to change. But I just think it's ridiculous that they're going to try to open up the schools knowing that, you know, they can't even have people in, you know, vote in person. But you want to have kids in school. And this is not only in, like, public education, but I know I've seen videos and pictures of some of my college classmates dropping their kids off at school.
Oh, wow.
They're going to be on campus. You know, so some campuses are open right now.
Huh.
And, you know, it's all just a recipe for disaster as far as I'm concerned. Or, you know, potential recipe. I'm not going to be doom and gloom, but yeah, it potentially could be devastating, and I wouldn't want that responsibility on my head if, you know, God forbid any student, child, or whatever catches it and then, you know, takes it home, you know, or, you know, catches it up, you know, up on campus and,
right,
you know, ends up inadvertently, you know, killing somebody up there or dying themselves or
yeah,
getting into a situation where they, you know, have long lasting health issues, you know, based on catching it. So, you know, there's no, nothing good I think is going to come out of it. And it's, you know, it's all opening up for the wrong reason.
Yeah. So, well, yeah. Speaking of which, I've seen the, Utah was opening up, and they had someone had interviewed one of the school nurses, and she was just like, she's completely against it, and was just like, for now, no, she's just going to send kids home much faster. You know, if you come in, you say you got a headache or maybe have a fever, you're out. You know what I mean? They're sending home, they're sending kids home quickly because you have five states that have already opened, and within like the 2 weeks, you already have 230 positive cases, you know what I mean, reported by different news sources within like those states. 230 within 2 weeks. And yet, you know what I mean, other states are continuing to move forward with their plans, you know what I mean, to open up. Arizona has had to make a 180 degree turn because they just had so many educators and staff members that said that they're just going to keep calling out sick until, you know what I mean? Right. So they were forced into doing distant learning, you know what I mean? Because they were another state that was just like, nah, we're just going to ignore the numbers and we're going to do what we want to do. And right now, some of them are basing it on funding, because it's within their guidelines or protocols or whatever that they have to have so many classroom hours in order to continue to get funding. In a situation like this, I don't know why you wouldn't go back to like your General Assembly if it's a state mandate. Or if it's a federal mandate that you wouldn't have like your representative doing something, you know what I mean, to waive that at this point. But, you know, it is what it is. We have a couple of guests lined up that's going to come on. One works a little in administration and the other one actually works in the classroom. And they're going to give us a little insight from their point of view. And what happened in their school districts and how they came about what they're going to do, at least for the first semester, to see how this whole thing ends, how this whole thing goes, and then they're going to go from there. Any thoughts before we bring on Danielle?
No, I mean, pretty much covered everything, you know. The only thing I would say is, you know, there's been at least stories I haven't seen anything in my research, but I've, you know, heard stories that, you know, there's teachers that are, you know, writing their wills and things like that. Also, but I have found that there, you know, in New Jersey, there was like 375 teachers that refused to come back.
Good.
They're refusing to come back to work. And then there's other, other issues that may, occur with, you know, funding directly, you know, based on issues with, you know, in person-to-person learning. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting.
Yeah, because on top of, like, we're talking about just, you know what I mean, the school staffing on one hand. What happens on the other hand when parents refuse to send their kids into that type of situation? I know we was just, my wife was telling me a news report that you can choose to teach a child at home due to homeschooling, and they'll supply you with, you know what I mean, materials and everything, but you can't just do it for one semester and be like, oh, all right, it's safe to go back to school, and then send them back. Like, no, if you choose to do it, you have to do it for like the whole year. And I think that there has to be some type of flexibility in there somewhere, you know what I mean, to safeguard your children. I mean, you're not only safeguarding your children, you're safeguarding your household. You know, to be honest with you, because that child is coming back home, you know. And if they're in a classroom, as we've already seen, like other students, you know what I mean, that's in the classroom with other students, and then next thing you know, the whole school gets shut down, your home also gets shut down. Because you don't know if you've been exposed.
Well, it's also one thing I didn't take into consideration until now. Not only just the teaching, it's the rest of the staff at the, you know, at the school. What's going to happen with them? Like what the, you know, from the janitors to, you know, cafeteria workers, teachers' aides, you know, all these, it just seems like it's going to be a logistical nightmare to,
Yeah.
To handle all this.
I seen one administrator say, like, if you don't want, like, for like teachers, he was addressing teachers anyway, and was just like, if you don't like it, then take a sabbatical. And I think that's a very flip, you know what I mean, type of attitude when you're not directly in the school. You're not directly in the classroom. You know what I mean? You sit in your office somewhere else and puts everybody else at risk because you're safe. You're safe where you are. So Danielle, you want to introduce yourself to the audience and tell us what your title is and what it is you do within the school system?
All right. Hello, everyone. I am Danielle, and I'm a consulting teacher. I support new teachers in my district. The teachers on my caseload, I actually observe and create an instructional support plan to give them feedback to coach and professional development so that new teachers will go and become experts. Excellent teachers. So that is what I do.
Great.
So can you walk us through like what happened? You know what I mean? When the governor first decided that he was going to shut down the state and shut down the schools, how much notice were you given to start preparing for like this distant learning? And yeah, just walk us through the whole thing.
Well, the initial announcement was very abrupt from the governor. So they made a decision, and, you know, our district had the quick turnaround. We pretty much created packets for students that were similar to winter break or spring break packets because at that time, not all students had technology. And we were pretty much home, you know, that first 2 weeks. But during that 2 weeks, our superintendent and her staff did a great job surveying teachers, administrators, and school staff on how we would proceed. And so after that 2 weeks, they came up with a really developed a plan for teachers to receive instruction in technology, pretty much how to use Google Classroom, Pear Deck, different types of tech tools, how we would do computer distribution so the students who don't have access to technology at home could get computers from their local school. They reached out to Comcast and Verizon, and in some cases was able to get families without the internet access so that they would be able to do online learning. They changed the dates for our spring break a little bit and gave teachers time to get the training, gave students time to get the technology, and then after a couple of weeks, we were ready for distance learning.
Wow. That's a
so
big turnaround.
It was a quick turnaround, but our county did an excellent job, and it's not always spotlighted in the news. Mm-hmm. They did an excellent, that's gorgeous Prince George's County, an excellent job doing the best that they could to train teachers within that time. Mm-hmm. We had webinars, you know, Zoom, tons of Zoom meetings, but they tried their best to give us all the resources we needed to continue learning for our students.
Awesome. What were your preparations for, like, this upcoming school year?
Okay. So, again, the first thing they definitely did was hold town hall meetings.
Okay.
Our superintendent wanted to get the feedback from parents.
Mm-hmm.
Because we know no plan is going to be perfect. You know, it's not going to be perfect for teachers. Teachers want to be face-to-face with their students. But, of course, we got to put the health of everyone first, but some situations at home aren't necessarily ideal, but she reached out to parents, she listened to teachers, she did surveys, we figured out resources, and starting this week, actually, our new teachers, so something to think about, this year, you're going to have teachers who are brand new to teaching.
Right.
So it's one thing to have 15 years of experience, and then to go into quarantine and to be in a pandemic and teach virtually. But we're going to have some people fresh out of college or career changers who are teaching for the first time, and this is how they're doing it. And so we actually have a department of professional learning who does a boot camp. This week was completely voluntary for new teachers, but they're learning about technology. They're learning a little bit about our county.
Mm-hmm.
Next week is mandatory for new teachers where they learn about the curriculum and, again, how they're going to be observed and all the technology. And then the week after that, we will have a professional development plan.
Okay.
Where everyone will virtually learn about some of the how we're going to bridge the gap between what students may have missed fourth quarter and what they need to learn first quarter.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're going to learn about those resources. And we have a T3 team who are the ones who teach us about different technology tools that we can use, like breakout rooms or chat features. But it's still not perfect, because what do you do if you are in kindergarten learning to read? You know, what if your parent has to work, but you have a young student? It's easy for me with a 13-year-old. I can make sure he's in front of the computer. I can check his work, but I don't have to stand over him. If I had an elementary school student, that would be a little more difficult. So it's not perfect. And then also we do have an elementary school student, but we have two parents who are working from home.
Right.
So it's not perfect. But I know for a fact, like, our superintendent was one of the first to announce that the whole first semester would be virtual learning.
Okay.
So our teachers, at least, we feel safe.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our students, we feel a little secure. And we know that she's put in our best interest first. You know, so, those are some of the things that she's doing, or our county is doing, to make sure teachers are prepared. Ideally, though, most people agree that I think teachers needed more time back before the students join us virtually to really plan, because there is a learning curve for people who are tech savvy and those who are not.
Okay.
You need time to adjust and modify your lessons to go in a virtual platform.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, we'll do the best we can with what we have.
All right. And speaking with someone that has a son, this is going to be, I think, his first year in high school, and one of the frustrations that she said that she had was that there weren't that I guess the lesson would have came across a little better, or he would have been able better prepared if he would have had an actual textbook. Is there some type of technology or things that they're going to be able to tap into online that's going to, I mean, because we're talking about distant learning, something has to replace the textbook so that they can be able to read and follow along and be able to get, like, the lesson. Is what is the plan for that, or has that even been addressed?
I'm glad you said that, because two things. The first thing is that I need people to remember that just like this is a crisis, you know, for you, it's a crisis for us.
Right.
You know, so to show a lot of grace to your teachers,
mm-hmm.
that some teachers are going to jump out there and do an amazing job right away, and other teachers are going to need support. So, and then, you know, teachers are human too, so they got issues at home, just like everybody else. So just definitely remember that. That's number one. But with regards to the textbooks, we had already been moving to online textbooks anyway.
Oh, beautiful.
So, yes. So in our county, students, I think maybe they brought home their math book, so they had a math book at home and one at school. But like right now, most of our textbooks are also online.
Okay.
So they might not have a hard copy, but they do have access to the textbook that they could, you know, see the pages. If they're visual, they could see everything right in front of them, have access to it for homework, etc. Yep. So most of our textbooks are online.
Okay. How much was the process of speaking with, like, the parents and the teachers and everything? How much of a gravity was the voices of everybody that's involved given when deciding what was going to happen for this upcoming school year?
Can you repeat that question? I'm sorry.
No problem. What gravity was the voices of the parents and the teachers? I don't know if the teacher union had anything to do with it, that brought the decision to do distance learning, at least until January. How much did that weigh in on that decision?
Very heavily, because once again, at town halls and surveys went out, and she actually shared the results of the survey results. And only 12% of teachers said that they were comfortable coming into school for teaching. 46% or so, and this is available on our website, 46% or so said that they would consider a hybrid model where we came in part of the days, but not all.
Mm-hmm.
But for the most part, most most teachers and most parents were more comfortable doing virtual learning or a combination of virtual and in-person. So they definitely took our feedback, and I think that's a part of her confidence in making a decision to have the whole first semester be virtual learning.
All right. And looking at some of like the reports from some of the schools that have already opened, I find like some of like these numbers absolutely staggering, to be honest with you. And I know you said you have a 13-year-old. When you look at Georgia was as MSN reports, Georgia was one of the last states to close, one of the first states to reopen. They had a young lady, I'm probably sure you're familiar with, Miss Hannah Waters. She was the young lady that took a picture of the students in the class in the, walking down the hallway, and ended up getting suspended for it. But within the first week, they already had to shut down the school. They had at least about 35 cases, and they had to shut down the school for cleaning and so on and so forth. When you look at a lot of the other states that have already opened, I think they said within the school system, you give me a moment, with Alabama, Georgia, Alabama, Indiana, Mississippi, Oklahoma have all come up with at least 230 reported cases. How much do you think that's going to weigh in when we start talking about January, if those numbers don't start coming down?
Well, first, for us, the decision to open in February is not permanent. Mm-hmm. In December, they're going to reevaluate to determine if we need to continue with virtual learning.
Okay.
And trust me, those were some of the questions we had. So what happens if I, as a teacher, come in contact with a student with COVID? Now, each of those students have to quarantine. I have to quarantine. Are you expecting a substitute teacher, you know, to take my place, knowing that, you know, they have been exposed to COVID in that particular classroom? And then if I get sick from COVID, am I using my personal sick leave? You know, is the county liable because I caught COVID at school? I mean, there were a lot of questions that educators have, and I think that played a big role in why they decided to start the year in the first 2 quarters of a virtual learning.
Okay.
There were tons of questions.
The whole liability thing, I to be honest with you, I didn't even think about that. But yeah, I guess that's a really good point. You know, who's going to be liable for this? Because not only do you have teachers, students, you have administrative workers, you have the cafeteria staff and everything else. I've seen a couple of pictures of some of the classrooms that they had set up with the kids pretty much in like for lack of better words, it's just like a box up and around like their desk, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was just like, wow, man, this has got to be extremely, extremely distracting, you know what I mean, when you're trying to learn something and you're just looking through like this plexiglass. So
you know, but as they say, you know, we'll do what we have to do at some point, and this has become our new normal. But one other thing I wanted to add was that at the end of last school year, our county actually lost a few staff members. We lost several, and one school lost, I think, three, a guidance counselor, a Spanish teacher, and someone else, all due to COVID. Mm-hmm. I think that may have also weighed on that decision as well, you know, because each life is precious. But yes. I know we lost at least 5 staff members total in our county at the end of the year due to COVID, and we just want to prevent that from happening at all in the fall.
How was the decision, like, who decided who got computers and the, what was it, Wi-Fi, I believe, hot zones or something? I can't, forgive me if I can't get the right terminology. You go into the homes. How was that decision made?
I'm not able to answer how hotspots were determined. Mm-hmm. The Comcast, you know, Comcast and whoever, whatever company they use, pretty much determine.
Okay.
And I'm not sure if they used income or anything like that. But as far as computers go, we had some schools that were already one-to-one, meaning that there was one device, whether it was a laptop, Chromebook, iPad, per student.
Mm-hmm.
And so what they did, they just redistributed so that every student who requested one,
okay,
for the most part, could get one. And, but for this upcoming school year, what's going to happen is anyone who did not get a device in the spring, mm-hmm, they get one in the fall, and they're going to keep that device until they graduate from high school.
Oh, okay.
Now, what that's going to look like if you're elementary and, you know, you have the same device for 6 or 7 years, I don't know. But at least for this year, it's going to be assigned to that student.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, they have to return it, but they can hold on to it until they graduate our county.
I can tell you what it looks like. Because obviously things have changed since I was in high school. But, yeah, it looks just like it did when you got, like, that same textbook from 10 years ago. It's your sister, yeah. A couple of your other older cousins, maybe your aunt and aunt. Yeah, it looks just like that. Just joking. But our senator, Paul Sarbanes, in the first COVID relief plan had secured over $200 million for Maryland schools. I'm thinking that probably most of that money went towards technology. I don't know. I just know that he sent me an email telling me, you know what I mean, that he had secured like a lot of money for like for Maryland schools for this upcoming school year. My last question is pretty much you would be the perfect person to ask. In speaking to, looking at what happened in Virginia and speaking with a couple of other parents that I work with, having issues, not with a lot of teachers, but just one here and there, that pretty much came on, logged in, took attendance, was like, this is your lesson, was out. They were very frustrated. They're emailing the guy. Maybe he'll email, but you know what I mean? It's just like, I can answer, he can answer, like, you know, you may get an answer to your question, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's answering your question, you know?
Yeah.
And he was very, like, very short and flip, you know what I mean, to you know, speak casually. Not, you know what I mean, because I didn't speak to him, you know what I mean, personally. But he just seemed like he was very difficult to get in contact with, very difficult to get answers from as to what, you know what I mean, the lesson plan was, what the kids were supposed to be doing, and so on and so forth. What measures, what happened, you know what I mean, during the end of like the last semester, how do I want to word this? What measures are being taken for oversight for like these type of teachers? Because apparently, you know what I mean, in a lot of places, I'm not saying like in PG County, because I know we have cousins in Virginia, and Virginia was just to the point where they just said, forget it, never mind, this isn't working. What steps are being taken for oversight so that this doesn't continue to happen and, you know what I mean, start to fester with other teachers like, oh, that's all you got to do?
That's a great question. And I'm going to start with saying that word grace again, because at the end of last year, you know how they say you're building a plane as you were flying it.
Mm-hmm.
So some people, if you were really comfortable with technology, you did a lot. I would say for our, he was in the seventh grade last year, 4 out of 5 teachers were on top of their game.
Okay.
One person set up a Zoom, and it was nothing but kids on the Zoom, and the teacher was nowhere to be found.
Wow.
So, you know, you communicate with that person, but you know that they're trying to figure this out as well, and not everybody's on the same page. But I will say that accountability is crucial, and that's a county-to-county and a school-to-school thing. In our county, there's some system, I'm not sure what it's called, but administrators have been trained on it so that they have access to teachers' Google Classroom.
Mm-hmm.
Ingenuity or something like that. So they can actually, our administrators tend to list, pop in on the Zoom sessions. And, you know, of course, parents can always email the teachers, email the administrator, the principal, or vice principals. But this year, at the end of last year, they suspended all observations, formal observations, for example, because that will count towards the teacher's evaluation at the end of the year.
Okay.
But for this upcoming year,
mm-hmm.
you know, no, they're being observed, you know, they're being evaluated. And so there is a level of accountability. But honestly, and unfortunately, it's a still a school-to-school basis. So mm-hmm. if that administrator's holding the teacher accountable, then you'll see a change.
Okay.
If the administrator is kind of flying by, you know, their pants as well, then you may not see that change right away. But it's still a learning curve for most people.
Mm-hmm.
So just, you know, email the teachers, but be a little bit patient. And then, and then you have your support from your school counselors as well. But it's really all about accountability. And I know that there have been measures set up in our county.
Okay.
To support teachers first, but also to hold them accountable.
Okay. No, you got anything
but
you want to add?
I do want to say that's a frustration thing, though, because we talk a lot about equity.
Yes.
Now, especially with a lot of things that have been happening in the news. And one concern is, you know, I could have 2 fourth-grade students, and one could have a phenomenal teacher, and another one might have one that, like you said, posts videos, and then you don't hear from them again for the rest of the week. So it is a concern, you know, it is not perfect, but there are some measures in place, and honestly, we just have to see how it goes.
Me and Nube were having this conversation last Saturday, and looking at some of like these reports and everything, I've changed my stance a little bit, because I'm gonna be honest, I was going into it like, if it's not going to be any students in the class in the school, I don't see why the teachers can't go. He disagreed. We went back and forth, and looking at some of like these numbers and like the spread, I think that the a lot of these places where they are opening up the schools and sending the kids back are doing this blindly. And I think the one student, Hannah Ward, is the one that I was referring to earlier, made a really good point. It's like they just sent them back to school as guinea pigs just to see what would happen later. And
yes.
you. On one hand, you have these governors and these mayors and these superintendents making these speeches about, oh, we just have to practice. We just got to follow safe practice. You know what I mean? Statutes and, you know what I mean, go by the guidelines of the CDC. Well, the CDC told everybody stay home.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And you having like... we're talking about hundreds of kids in the school. You know what I mean? PG County is about how many students are we talking about in PG County? Roughly.
Let's just say I know we have over 230 something schools, and I know in my old school we had 900 students in one building.
Right.
So we have a lot. 100,000 maybe.
Well, that's what I was thinking. You know what I mean?
I don't know.
Yeah, and you know, the county is still, you know what I mean? Well, they're still building more and more housing, so the numbers are only going to continue to increase.
Yes.
Like I said, I changed my stance, because at first I was like, I don't see a problem with it, you know what I mean? Like, ain't going to be any students there, you know what I mean? You should be able to go in, have your classroom, maybe that'll make the teachers feel a little more comfortable and so on and so forth, but... At the rate that they're going and the way that they're going about it, I don't think that I don't really think that there's really any concern. When I watched the interview with, I believe it was the superintendent for Virginia, and the reporter flat out asked him, what are you going to do with your children? You got school age children. Are you going to send them to school? And his response was like, oh, well, you know, we're going to talk about that tonight at dinner. Come on, man.
Yeah,
stop.
Right.
Stop.
They made
stop.
Up their mind already.
You exactly. You have already seen the numbers. You've already been in meetings with the school board, with parents, with the teachers. You already know what it is. You know what I mean? You already know what you're going to do with your kids. You know what I mean? Nah, my wife is going to stay at home, and we're going to homeschool from here on out. Or we got a private school where it's only like 10 kids in a classroom, blah, blah, blah. Whatever the case is, I find it amazing that so many people are willing to sacrifice other people's children.
Other people. And see, we need at the table at the national, at the state and national levels, mm-hmm. and we already know that at the national level, that person, they need to send their own kids to public schools, let alone consult actual public school teachers when making decisions, you know, about what happens in education. But that's why it's so important that educators are part of that conversation,
mm-hmm.
whether it's group surveys or town hall meetings or roundtables, so that you can get the true perspective of people who would actually be in that situation.
Right.
Can you imagine, you know, kids wearing masks for 7.5 hours a day and you telling them, like, kindergarten is not to touch each other?
Yeah.
Like, you know, sometimes we look at whether it's the CDC guidelines or any other guidelines, we'll look at them and say, this person's obviously not a teacher. They obviously don't know what it's like to be in a classroom. Yeah. You know, so that's important when it comes to decision making. Definitely.
Yeah. When I take my grandson to the store, he's 3. We're only in the store for like 15, 20 minutes, and he didn't already took the mask off like about 4 or 5 times. You know, he got me Saturday. This dude took it off and stuffed it down his shirt. I'm looking around. I'm thinking he done dropped it on the floor. I'm like, oh, come on, man. What did you do with this thing? He's like, oh, it's in my shirt, Papa. Like, man, what are you doing? Yeah, man. So, yeah, I can only imagine, especially like, you know what I mean, the older kids. You know, but the younger ones, you know what I mean? We start talking about the attention span and everything else, and they have to sit there with a mask on, sitting behind like the plexiglass and everything else. I think this is going to be very interesting. But, you know, I mean, my deeper views, you know what I mean, is that this just goes, you know what I mean, further towards the erosion of a public school system. But that's the issue for another day.
And I do want to say, we do have the option. Teachers in our county, if they chose to, can work from their classroom if they choose to.
Okay.
I think they said the option. So, because, you know, some teachers have kids too. So, in some cases, they may choose, you know, to work from home so they can make sure their kids are learning too. And my prayer, because I don't know what else to offer for, like, essential workers and people who don't have the privilege of working from home,
mm-hmm.
you know, but they have children and they may not have another caregiver to watch their kids, especially if they're younger.
Right.
That is a big concern. And then our students who have autism or special needs, you know, and they really need that hands-on support.
Uh-huh.
So we don't have it all figured out yet, but I don't want to be a guinea pig. So, you know, I'm happy that we're definitely doing the virtual learning thing first.
All right. Anything you want to add, Nuke?
No, I was actually going to ask about special needs provision. She already mentioned it. So, yeah, perfect.
Yeah, and I don't have the answer to that yet. I think that's
right,
something that you're still figuring out.
Right. Okay, great.
All right.
I learned a lot. So, yeah, this was a great. Appreciate you taking the time to come and speak.
No problem. Thank you for reaching out.
All right. Well, Danielle, hope you have a wonderful distant first semester. And then we'll see how it go. Maybe we'll do this again. You said, when is it in? Like January, February, something like that?
Yeah, the end of the first quarter is mid or the end of January.
Okay.
So yeah. After that, I think maybe January 31st, whatever the last full week of January is. But in December, they should be making a decision for what we'll do the third quarter.
All right. Yeah. I wish you the best of luck. Let's go, gorgeous Prince George's. Shout out to the Heights and nobody else. All right. All right. Thanks, Danielle.
You're welcome. You guys have a good day. And thank you, you know, for considering the educator's perspective.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right. So we're going to switch gears real fast, and what we're going to do is we're going to show you a pre-recorded interview with an actual educator, Laura, who actually is in, who teaches in the classroom, and we're going to get like her opinion and see how everything went in her district and how they set up whatever it is that they're going to do for like the for the next school year.
Thank you.
Good. Can you walk us through like your last day in school, and how that came about. Did you get like a call to the principal's office and like, hey, pack your stuff. We can't let you back in the building tomorrow. What happened?
No. The last day, I don't even know what that was. March 13th, March 16th, something in there.
Yeah.
I teach in a high school, teach ninth graders, I teach juniors, I'm an English teacher. And our last day, the day before, there was a lot of talk. There was a lot of talk about, you know, the pandemic and things that were happening. And I remember people were starting to talk about toilet paper and how the toilet paper was not in stores. And so I decided to stop at Target on the way home to get some other random stuff. And I was like, I'm going to go look at the toilet paper aisle. And sure enough, there was like, it wasn't all gone, but there was less. And I was like, I'm just going to get some. So I got some toilet paper. And then I was just doing my Target thing, walking around. And then one of my teacher friends texted me because the governor was having a press conference. And that's when she said, just, you know, Hogan just closed the schools for 2 weeks. And my mind was literally blown. I just couldn't believe the schools were closed for 2 weeks. So we had to go in the next day. And that was going to be our last day. And I guess that, I think it was a Friday. I think it was a Friday was our last day.
Yeah.
And then we were going to be gone for 2 weeks. And at the time, I remember thinking, 2 weeks is such a long time. And here we are. And now we're going to be all virtual for the foreseeable future. So that's what I remember. I remember thinking 2 weeks is going to be such a long time to not be in school. That's longer than our Christmas break. That's longer than our spring break. And I never would have guessed that it would have been this by now.
So when you went back, during that 2 weeks, did they contact you for like training and how to set up like this distant learning? How did that come about?
I have a lot of teacher friends who are in other positions, like content area specialists, and they do other work outside of the classroom. So I was hearing snippets just because of who my friends are.
Mm-hmm.
But the whole first week that we were out, it was pretty much radio silence. Because just nobody knew what to do. I remember telling my students, we were just about to start writing an essay. And when we found out we would be closed for 2 weeks, we came into school for one last day. And I told them, I said, you know what? By the time we come back in 2 weeks, I think it's going to be silly to try to do this essay. We're going to lose so much class time. Get the essay, we're going to start a new unit. And so, like, in my mind, we weren't going to, I didn't think we needed to teach those 2 weeks, just because it was such a weird, like, I kind of just thought, we'll come back in 2 weeks, and we'll just continue on with teaching. And I wasn't really expecting to go into any kind of virtual learning until sometime within that 2 weeks, we found out we'd be closed longer.
Mm-hmm.
The closure came in like several steps. It was like, oh, closed till 2 weeks. Now we're going to be closed until April 1st. Now we're going to be closed, you know, and they just sort of kept stretching it. So in the first 2 weeks, I don't know that anybody was really talking about it, because I think we all thought we were going back. And then it became, no, we have to get these kids online learning.
Okay.
Knowing that when we're going to go back. And so our school district kind of set up the process. I don't think that there was a lot of teacher involvement because it had to get rolled out so quickly because we'd already lost time.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to figure out how I want to word this or whatever. So at no point, like you said, you know what I mean? Y'all just kept expecting like, oh, we're going back. Oh, we're going back. We're going back. How did that affect your curriculum and how you went about, you know what I mean, teaching? What adjustments did you have to make as they kept extending it, I guess is what I'm asking.
I just kept thinking about if we returned, like what would be the most important things that I get done?
Mm-hmm.
And as I started to realize, and I started to believe we're not going back. I was like, I don't think we're going to go back this year. I really don't. And a lot of people thought that we will by May. We'll go back in May. And then when they actually had us start our virtual learning, there was a lot of talk about equity. What would be equitable for the students and equitable for the staff? Meaning, you know, we had just nobody was prepared. like, there, we have areas of our county that are too rural to have internet access.
Mm-hmm.
We have, obviously, students who don't have, you know, internet, don't have the computer infrastructure, all that stuff. So even in terms of just getting everybody materials, getting everybody equipment, that was one whole issue. But then it was like there came this, like, equity of if one teacher teaches their students in a certain way and another teacher teaches it totally different, is it going to be equitable? Like, can I expect all of my students to have a laptop so that if I want to do this lesson that I would have done in school, they could all receive it? And I think somewhere in those conversations, it was decided to give the kids the same curriculum across the board.
Okay.
So the school system bought something, and we as teachers became the management of it. So we had, like, assigned students that we had to manage. It wasn't even our actual students. So we just got kind of like our homeroom that we don't teach.
Oh, wow.
And we just pushed out pre-made lessons for all the core content. It was only the core content. So English, history, math, science.
Okay.
And that they got that up and running quickly. But then the conversations turned to, what about all the other teachers? What about all the other curriculum? You know, all that. And so we sort of added a secondary layer to it where we then had to go back and start teaching our own students.
Okay.
And it just, I mean, every school system said this. It was emergency learning. That was no virtual learning. That was emergency learning. So how we had to adjust our curriculum was a mess because at that point, they had made decisions about making the semester or making the quarter just simply like a pass-fail. And as long as kids made an attempt to do something, they would pass. And I think that was hard for students and it was hard for teachers because it's really difficult to pour your heart and soul into a lesson when you know that because they logged on 2 weeks ago, they're passing whether they do this lesson or not. So it was just kind of like the way that the county set it up, I think just made it disheartening for the kids, disheartening mm-hmm. for the teachers. And I'm not surprised that a lot of teachers and a lot of students just didn't put their all in for that quarter. And there was just so much mental strain going on, the uncertainty, the constant changing everything. But I think, and I heard somebody say this, you know, teachers are so burnt out by the end of the school year and they are so ready to be done. And this was like at times a thousand. So by the time June came around, I was like, did you log on? Did you not log on? You've already passed the year. Who cares? Who cares at this point? We just need to be done and start planning for the fall because what has to happen in the fall has got to look 100% different because we all know this was terrible. And mm-hmm. I don't think it's a good thing to kind of – I think you learn from what happened in the spring, but okay. I think what happened is so many people took that and made a lot of judgments about how it's going to go in the fall
mm-hmm.
when really I think most good schools, most good teachers are trying to change that perception completely because it was awful. It really was.
Noob, you wanted to jump in there?
Yeah, well, the questions that I have aren't really directly on topic for that. I know I was looking at an article in New Jersey where they said like 375 teachers are refusing to go back to work when they, you know, forced the schools open with COVID. Mm-hmm. Do you have any, experiences with coworkers that have been given that same sentiment?
We, the talk for this upcoming school year, I heard a lot about doing a hybrid in my county, where they were going to try to have kids going only like certain days of the week and then not to spread them out and all this stuff. And I kept saying, it's an all or nothing to me. Either
right.
It's safe and we all go back and it's normal, or it's not safe and nobody goes back. Because
right.
I don't think you can do two things at once well. And if you're still going to have kids learning virtually, you've got to put your energy into that. You can't be telling me that I'm going to the classroom some days, and other days I got to teach them online. Like, how am I? I'm not going to be good at either one.
Right.
So we ended up getting to the point where it was decided it was going to be all virtual. And that made me feel better because at this point, I don't think it's a good idea if people can get sick and people have to quarantine and all this stuff, I don't understand why we force teachers and kids to go into a situation that can be really unsafe. It's right. The point of, like, logistics. Say they go back and say somebody does have to quarantine, and then you trace it to all the people that were in contact. Like, you're constantly going to have this influx of students and teachers not in the building. That's not going to be conducive for learning.
Right.
So we got to the point where it's going to be all virtual, and then there was a big discussion about teachers still going into their classrooms empty to do the lessons virtually versus
right.
telework.
Right.
And oh my gosh, that was a huge debate in our county, huge debate. I'm on the telework side. I'm a really good teacher when I have kids in front of me. So I'm right. not really sure what teaching in an empty class, I'll just be doing it virtually. Whereas I can be sitting in my home office also doing it virtually. So I didn't understand why they really wanted teachers in the classroom. So it came down to a choice. You had to pick whether you like telework or you want to go to your classroom. And for me, I have kids. I have my own two children at home who have to do virtual right. learning. And so, like, I need to be here to double check. Now the elementary age child, and I have to make sure he's getting on and doing these things. So
right.
for me, that was a big thing. So I think, and I've seen lots of teachers, lots of school districts, you know, teachers don't feel comfortable going back. I think a lot of them. And I think it's terrible to force it. I don't know. To me, it's like the data hasn't changed since we closed. If it was unsafe
exactly.
then,
right.
is it still unsafe now?
Right.
With that in mind, the young lady that posted the picture, within like their first week or two of school, about 35 people tested positive, and they end up having to shut the school down for like 2 weeks anyway. And it was
uh-huh.
just like, then to me, if you're going to end up, you know what I mean, get to a certain number and you have to shut the school down, then there's no point in even opening it, you know. Just go and continue to do what you're doing. And I think that some of these states have wasted a lot of time in not preparing to to be able to go online, because they have like this, for whatever reason, have this forced mandate that you have to be in the classroom. And
yeah.
I don't understand it, because I just find it, me personally, I just find it ridiculous that you have these governors and you have these superintendents talking about following safe guidelines, yet you're shoving 30, you know what I mean, whatever students into a classroom. You have hundreds of kids in a hallway when the classes change, especially when we're talking about high school and middle school. It's not like elementary school where everybody stays in their own classroom. You know what I mean? High school, you know, everybody's switching rooms, and there's absolutely positively no way that you can go in and disinfect the room within, what is it? They have like 6 minutes to get to the next class. Five. Okay, I tried to give them an extra 60. You have 5 minutes to get to your locker, get to your classroom, or do whatever it is you need to do to get there. You know what I mean? And yeah, I think that that it was very poor judgment on a lot of like these districts, especially in these states that have very high numbers. You know what I mean, of people testing positive. So. What did you prepare? How did you prepare for like this upcoming school year? And what role did the county play in helping teachers prepare for distant learning?
Well, I definitely think schools have to make this decision early, because, like you said, it's like going in the classroom for a few weeks and everybody comes home. I'm sure those teachers aren't going to be prepared to do anything virtual, because you've been doing it in person and it's very different. Our county had us do a lot of trainings. We had some hours to make up because there were some days where there was no virtual learning, but we were getting paid, so we had to make up some stuff. So they basically got us trainings for the platforms we will be using. And there's lots of additional trainings that you can take. And the way that works in my county is teachers go back to school 1 week for the students. That whole week is all going to be virtual, but we will be doing sessions. I now use to deliver that content. It's like, there's only so many trainings I can sit through before I just need time to piece together what I need to do. Right. Give me the time. So the way my school's going to do it is we get, like, the afternoon or the morning is, like, individual planning, or you can do Zoom calls with people that you work with or whatever you want to do. Just like if you were in your room at school and you had no more meetings that day, you sat there and you planned. And then they're going to offer a bunch of professional development on a variety of topics. They asked me to lead one because I'm going to lead a topic about creating classroom culture while teaching the technology. Like, these kids have to learn how to use Microsoft Teams. They have to learn how to use this thing that we're using called Synergy. They have to learn how to use Zoom. And so I want to do a session on teaching the tech, but I want to teach it while I try to make kids have a class culture, get to know each other, because that's, I can't have engagement unless we have relationships, and you know, there's this literal barrier of the screen. So I got to figure out, so I've been working with another teacher, and we've kind of figured out ways to get kids connected, do breakout rooms, do group chats, do group things, see each other, do fun activities. But while we're doing that, teaching the tech that we'll need, so by the time I get some actual content, we have procedures, we know what's going on. And so our school, I think we're just a lot of professional development, lots of sessions about everything.
Okay. Noob, you want to jump in there?
No, that was pretty much the main question I had. Definitely eye-opening, and I think it kind of gives me a better perspective on what some of the teachers issues may be, you know, some of the barriers they may have, and then kind of figuring out, you know, creative ways to create, you know, meaningful engagement. Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, I think a lot has changed too, because in the spring, we actually didn't do any live sessions. There were some security issues with Zoom.
Right. So
we were told, don't do anything live. And so all we were doing was sending out assignments, which, I mean, that's not very engaging. I knew it. They knew it. So this year, we have created virtual expectations for the students, and we also have virtual expectations for the teachers. And the way that they're going to do it is we actually have to teach 4 classes a day, and you have to teach. Well, the students take 4 classes a day. I, as a teacher, teach 3, and I have a planning period. We have to teach a live session for 60 minutes and then follow up with a 30-minute not live session where they can go on and continue to work on their assignments or ask us for help, like via just messaging stuff. So now we are required to actually do live stuff, and they got Zoom in a secured way. So I think that's going to change the face of teaching altogether, because before, teachers could just sort of post an assignment, kids would do it, 10 minutes, you're done. But now I have to get up, and my start date, start time is 8:05. I teach online unless I have a planning period and we have a lunch break and stuff. But I'll be teaching live every day. We're doing live teaching Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, Friday, and then Wednesday is offline for more professional development planning.
Okay.
Will you be wearing a mask?
What? I'm not wearing a mask. We might do some first dance. We'll go out with our little signs. I was holding my sign, have the kids hold up theirs, and we're trying to get them to do a mask sign because I feel like it's just indicative of our time. But I'm not excited because, like, I was really sad in the spring because I had grown to know my students really well. We were a very close-knit group. And then they were just, like, gone. Like, I was online with them, but I didn't see them again. We had some chats. I never saw them again, and so I'm kind of excited for in the fall to literally see my kids. We're going to ask kids to keep their faces on the video. I don't think we can mandate they have to. Another equity thing, you know, if kids don't want to show their backgrounds, their rooms, their houses, whatever. But we're going to try to make it something we would like to happen. So, like, I told both of my own children, put your video on. Like, your teacher doesn't know you. They need to see who you are. Big difference.
It's funny that you said that, because I forgot if it's I don't want to name the county just in case I'm wrong, but they actually did put a mandate in saying, like, no, you have to have your camera on for a certain amount of time so that they know, so that the teachers know that you're actually still there. And that you didn't just, you know what I mean, log in for attendance and then just walk away and you got back to, like, you know, Call of Duty. So, yeah, it's one county that actually did mandate, no, you have to have your camera on and your microphone so they know that you're actually there.
There, yeah.
What are your plans for January at the end of the semester? Are y'all, has the county already set, like, dates to sit down and decide whether they're going to continue, or is that going to be something that's done on the fly?
They developed a phase approach. I watch our school board meetings via, you know, they record them in, on Zoom and everything, or whatever they use. And basically, they come up with some plans, and then the school board votes on it, and different contingencies were worked out, and they decided to call it a phase plan. So we're going to be in phase one, all virtual, et cetera. Phase two involves, and I don't know what the numbers, I don't know what the data is going to be used to move us into this phase or didn't go that far, but like phase two, they really want to get special populations back in the classroom because it's harder for them to learn online.
Okay.
Kids with IEPs, kids with 504s, English language, second language, English as a second language learners, homeless students. So once it's deemed okay, they want to allow them to come back in the classroom. And then I don't know how that's going to work, though, because somebody's got to go teach. I don't know how that's going to go. And then after that, phase three is it's safe for everybody to go back. They have no timeline for any of that. I think we're going to be definitely virtual the entire first semester. And I think it's all going to depend on what happens, you know, with the data. I mean, I don't know. I don't think anybody has an idea of when it's going to be safe. Is safe when there's a vaccine? Because you, as you said before, you can't do any of the social distancing, any of the, anything in a high school. Our numbers are too big. Our rooms are too small. I already teach. I've been teaching and I have a portable classroom that was
built.
I've been there. This will be my 16th year, and I've been in the temporary classroom for 13 years.
Oh, wow. I thought you started at a brand new school.
I started the year the school opened. It was brand new, and I taught in the building for the first 3 years, and then we got overcrowded. And they built a temporary building. It's nice. It's like going into a whole separate school, but it's like across the parking lot. It holds about 25 classrooms. And we still have teachers that don't have classrooms. So they have to float into your room during your planning. So, like, all those things, like, anytime they say, oh, well, just follow the guidelines. Yeah, in a high school, there's no way. There's too many kids. There's too much stuff.
Yeah, they need to stop building houses down that joke.
You know, they're building more houses. And they're like, you need to stop building houses and they need to build more schools.
Yeah.
And they've opened another high school my high school opened. There's another one that opened, and we're still overcrowded.
Open?
Like, most of the schools have the portable classrooms.
Gracious. What I need to do is open up a health department to start handing out condoms. Good gracious. Y'all got, like, a ridiculous amount of kids down there.
Where all the kids come from? And, I mean, there's, like, safety issues with that. Like, I don't have a restroom out in my building, so I have to leave my classroom, go down the hall, leave my building, cross the parking lot, and go in the main building. And they're like, oh, we'll give you hand sanitizer. I know, but, I mean, and we have passes for security. Like, there's just so many logistical things that you can't overcome just by saying, separate them, only bring in 5 kids at a time. You know, it's just, that's not real. So I don't know.
So I'm going to go past there in these next coming weeks and see if they done built you an outhouse for, like, this upcoming school year. That's crazy.
You know, and when they were asking us whether we wanted to telework or be in the classroom, I was like, my bathroom's like 5 steps right here. I have no commute. I can actually use the bathroom and wash my, like, little things like that, that when they get into this thing about, well, teachers need to be in the classroom teaching, I'm like, I'm not a pastor to talk to me. I'm not just,
Let me ask you this, for, like, the parents or as we're sitting here talking about safe, unsafe, and Maryland has pretty much, I think, for, like, the most part, for just about all the counties I've seen, no one is actually going to be in the classroom. And I could be wrong, but for, like, the most part, at least, you know what I mean, that I've seen, like PG, Montgomery, Howard, Baltimore, St. Mary's, all of them, you know what I mean? They all decided no one's going to be in the classroom. Yet, they're still having sports. How is that? You know what I mean? They're like, you can't come to school to learn, but you can still show up to practice for the football team. You can still show up to practice for the basketball team. That's considered safe, but sitting in a classroom isn't.
I know that our fall sports were doing their conditioning.
Yeah.
And we got a letter saying it's canceled as of right now because one of the players tested positive for COVID.
Okay.
And they could no longer do it. And I have heard of our sports teams picking back up. So I don't know what that decision is going to be. I mean, that's my whole thing. I don't think it's safe to be in the bus, to be on the field, to be in the school. That's my all or nothing. Either it's safe or it's not. I don't feel like, well, it's safe to have a soccer practice. Like, why is it safe to have a soccer practice? Aren't they going to be around each other? I mean, I don't understand it. So to me, I can't imagine why we'd be doing sports, but that's above my pay grade, I guess.
Yeah, because my one coworker, her son is plays football, and I'm like, well, I'm just like, oh, so what is he going to do? You know what I mean? Since there's no football, she's like, what are you talking about? They're practicing. I'm like, God, they're what? She's like, yeah, they're doing their all their conditioning now, and I think they start practicing like another week or two or something or whatever. And I'm like, huh? So you can't go to school. You can go to school to practice, but you can't go to school to learn. I was like, okay, I guess that's sports in America.
That's illogical. Yeah, that seems really illogical.
Yeah.
I teach argumentative writing, so to me, that's not to write that argument. There's no logic there to speak, but.
Yeah. All right. Any other questions, Newt?
Nope, not right, not at the moment.
All right. Yeah. We'd like to thank you so much for joining us on Seriously Joking. Thank you so much for your time and your candor. We appreciate it. And maybe by the end of the school year, maybe next year, we might be sitting down doing this again, depending on the situation and what they decide to do.
Fingers crossed. We're going back to the building. It's going to be safe.
Yeah, wash your hands.
All right. Well, thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.